Thank you everyone for joining us for this very important online seminar on the science and the policy of tobacco harm reduction. My name is Tim Andrews. I'm the Director of Consumer Issues at Americans for Tax Reform and the Tholos Foundation. The Tholos Foundation is for 20 years as an affiliate of Americans for Tax Reform has been working with groups around the world to try and spread messages of sound science and good public policy. The issue of tobacco harm reduction is one of the most pressing issues of our time. In the last year, more people have died from smoking-related illnesses than did during the COVID pandemic. If smoking remains the leading cause of mortality that is preventable around the world. Fortunately, the technology now exists through reduced risk harm alternatives that we can save millions of lives around the world. Through these innovative new technologies, proven to help smokers quit smoking, that are 95% safer than combustible cigarettes, we have an opportunity to save more lives with one simple change in policy than we have in generations. This is an incredible opportunity, but only if policymakers get the policy settings right. So this is why we've conducting this seminar, and it's specifically dedicated to what's happening right now in Taiwan. There are almost 5 million smokers in Taiwan, 5 million lives that we could potentially save. And currently the Taiwanese legislature is looking at ways to change their approach. So we've set up this seminar where you will hear from some of the leading experts from around the world, experts in science and in medicine, as well as experts in public policy and those who have researched what has happened in other countries, so that you will be able to be armed with the information, not just in Taiwan, but in other countries as well, to know what the best possible policy outcomes are to help save lives. Because at the end of the day, harm reduction is the moral issue. I think we all know people who have lost their lives because of smoking, and it's our moral responsibility to ensure that we have the policies to solve these problems and to save lives. Now, we have three panels before us today. The first one will primarily be focused on the science. The second one, which will be chaired by my colleague Lorenzo, will be focused on best practices and opportunities and lessons from around the world. And the third panel, which will be chaired by Lindsay from the Taxpayers Protection Alliance, will be focused on the policy and the regulatory lessons that we can learn and what governments should do. Please note that through Zoom, you should have opportunities to choose translation options. Make sure you select at the bottom which language you wish to hear this in. Most presentations will be in English, and there will be simultaneous translations into Mandarin. However, some presentations will be in Mandarin and they'll be translated into English. So for the first panel, we have with us four leading experts in the medical field. Our first speaker will be Dr. Colin Mendelson. Dr. Mendelson has over 30 years in practicing in smoking cessation. He was previously an associate professor at the School of Public Health and Community Medicine at the University of New South Wales. He's done hundreds of workshops and lectures around Australia, helping smokers quit. And he was the founding member of the Australian Tobacco Harm Reduction Alliance. Following Dr. Mendelson, we'll move to Dr. Brad Rodu, who is the first holder of the Endowed Chair in Tobacco Harm Reduction Research at the University of Louisville's James Graham Brown Cancer Center. For over 25 years, he has published research on tobacco harm reduction, and I think is known as one of the world's leading experts also in this field. Moving to our speakers from Taiwan, we have Professor James Yuan from the Department of Health and Welfare at the University of Taipei. Previously, he was a postdoctoral fellow at the Institute of Occupational Medicine and Industrial Hygiene at National Taiwanese University. and he is the assistant professor in the Department of Health and Welfare there now. Our final speaker will be Professor Kai Zhen, or KJ to make it easier for me to pronounce, who's a professor in the Department of Public Health, the joint appointment professor at the School of Public Health, and also in the master, a professor in the master's program in applied molecular epidemiology, also at the university in Taiwan. So to start off with, and so we have an overview of what is harm reduction, what are the principles, and what is the science, I would like Dr. Mendelsohn to commence these discussions.
Trust that's working. Okay, so look, thank you so much for asking me to participate in this really important seminar and talk about one of my favourite subjects. So Tim has alluded to the fact that smoking is the leading preventable cause of death in the world, and it kills 8 million people every year. Up to 2 in 3 long-term smokers will die prematurely from their smoking, and they'll lose on average 10 years of life, which is an extraordinary impact on public health. And smoking causes 1 in 5 cancer deaths and a whole range of diseases, which I'm sure most of you are familiar with. The fact is, though, that most smokers really actually do want to quit, and most try repeatedly to quit and unfortunately repeatedly fail. And in my work as a tobacco treatment specialist, I've found that very frustrating. The success rates are low, extremely low, when people try on their own. But even with the best medications in clinical trials, 85% of smokers will fail. So it's very challenging for smokers to actually succeed with quitting. Quitting is certainly our preferred choice. It's always the preferred option. But for those who can't quit, who are continuing to be at risk of smoking-related illness and death, we have now tobacco harm reduction. And this is basically about reducing the harm in smokers who are otherwise going to continue to smoke, who are unable or unwilling to quit. It's not about eliminating harm, but it's about reducing harm, and the products I'm going to talk about do dramatically reduce harm. And the principle here is replacing high-risk combustible products that burn tobacco, such as cigarettes and pipes, with lower-risk non-combustible alternatives. Because we know that almost all of the harm from smoking is from burning tobacco. So it's the 7,000 chemicals and toxins that are created when tobacco is burned that do most of the damage. Now, all of these products have no combustion. There is no smoke. So clearly the risk to health is dramatically reduced. Quitting harm reduction is an established strategy in drug use generally, and we use it in things like methadone for heroin users, people who use street heroin, who just can't quit, switch to methadone and dramatically reduce the harm and risks from that behaviour. I wanted to just make one point that nicotine, although it's addictive, is relatively benign, and wide range of leading international organisations have accepted that. Nicotine does not cause cancer, doesn't cause lung disease, and it only has a relatively minor role in heart disease. So we need to be realistic about the role of nicotine and far less concerned about it than in fact we are. What's also important is the risk continuum of nicotine replacement products. So what this graph shows is on the right of the graph, we have all the combustible products, which are very high risk.
燃烧式的烟品，它们是高风险，这些就像是水烟啊、纸烟等等。旁边有所谓的电子烟，还有其他尼古丁的替代疗法，这些是不燃烧的产品。而烟草减害的 目的就是让大家不要使用高风险产品，而改用低风险产品。最后呢，希望他们能够戒烟。当然，戒烟对某些人来说相当困难，但有些人的确可以成功戒烟。 那接下来我们就来看烟草减害的各类产品，有所谓电子烟。电子烟使用的就是用电池供电的装置，把尼古丁的液体加热成可以吸入的气溶胶。这个是目前戒烟最受欢迎的工具之一，它让吸烟者仍然有这种从手上到嘴部的这些感触，而且有各式各样的产品，大家可以从投影片上看到图片。除此之外，它也是最
from the UK show that e-cigarettes, when compared to other studies of other products such as varenicline, which isn't available, nicotine replacement products and Zyban, bupropion, was the most effective agent. And it's also so much more harmful. It's generally accepted that it's around 95% less harmful than smoking. And that's because there are so few chemicals in vapor. And those that are there are present in much smaller doses. So it's just a logical conclusion, and the research supports that it's far less harmful. The second type of reduced risk device are heated tobacco products. And these basically consist of a special tobacco stick, which is heated, not burned, in an electrical device. And this also delivers the hand-to-mouth behavior, the ritual of smoking, and it gives extra taste, tobacco-like taste, which it appeals to some people. And various bodies have made it quite clear from the research that we've got so far that these devices deliver far fewer of the harmful and potentially harmful chemicals that are in smoke. It's been approved, IQOS was approved in the United States by the FDA, as appropriate to promote public health, and the overall benefit is expected to be positive. The experience with these heated tobacco products has been quite extraordinary. For example, in Japan, heated tobacco products were introduced in 2016. Cigarette sales have fallen by an unprecedented 42% since that time, which is really an extraordinary drop. And the vast majority of that reduction is due to these heated tobacco products, which have been taken up with great enthusiasm. But these products are spreading rapidly around the world. IQOS in particular is available in 70 markets and is spreading to other countries. The third product is Swedish snus, which is popular in Sweden and Norway. And that's a finely ground form of moist tobacco in a little pouch, which is specially treated to remove some of the carcinogens. It's placed under the upper lip and delivers nicotine much like a cigarette, although not as quickly. And it's been shown in numerous studies to have minimal long-term health effects. But what is really important is that when this is taken up in a population, like in Sweden, the smoking rates plummet. Sweden has the lowest smoking rate in the EU, and it also has the lowest rate of smoking-related illness in the EU based on that high uptake of snus. And finally, more recently, we have nicotine pouches, which consist of pharmaceutical-grade nicotine in a cellulose matrix within a little pouch that also goes up under the upper lip. There's no tobacco. There are a range of other products that go in that to fill the pouch up, and it delivers a satisfactory dose of nicotine for smokers, a good dose, in fact, a high level of nicotine, which the smokers need, and the levels of toxicants are probably even lower than Swedish snus, so it's a much, much safer product. So finally, I just wanted to conclude by saying, just reminding that nicotine, that reducing harm for smokers who will continue to smoke in any case is the whole purpose of tobacco harm reduction for the smokers who can't quit or just don't want to quit smoking or nicotine. So what we're doing is we're replacing the combustible products with non-combustible nicotine or tobacco products. And these deliver the nicotine, which is what smokers are looking for, but without most of the toxic chemicals. These are effective quitting aids, and they can be used long term. So ideally, smokers who switch to these products will quit long term. And either way, they have dramatic improvements in health. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Colin. We'll now move on to one. And please, at the end of each panel, there will be an opportunity for questions and answers. So please submit your questions during the chat. And once that's done, we'll be able to, and you can do that in either Mandarin or in English. But for our next speaker, if we can now move on to Professor Rodu.
I want to thank the organizers for the opportunity to participate in this event, along with a host of very prestigious experts. After Dr. Mendelsohn's excellent orientation toward tobacco harm reduction and its products, I would like to focus on one of the big hurdles for tobacco harm reduction in the US, and it's a hurdle that is being used worldwide, and that is the an exaggeration of what has been called a teen vaping epidemic in the United States. I want to present another view of that epidemic. It has made headlines almost every year as survey information is released by the CDC and the FDA. They release selected information about a survey called the National Youth Tobacco Survey. They release that information about 6 to 8 months prior to releasing the data. It just so happens that data was released last week, and I have been able to conduct an analysis that I have released on my blog and that I'm going to discuss during this presentation. This is the last 10 years of the National Youth Tobacco Survey. Although the graph looks complicated at first, it's rather very simple. The lower dark blue bars are the smoking rate, that is the percentage of high school students that are currently smoking, defined as smoking in the past 30 days in the US over the past 10 years. The middle blue is the percentage of students who are using both cigarettes and e-cigarettes. And the gray bars at the top are the percentage that are vaping or using e-cigarettes only. You can see that the smoking rate has been declining for many, many years. In fact, even previously to this graph. But as that smoking rate has declined, you can see that starting in about 2013, the vaping rate started to go up. It went up sharply in 2018 and 2019, but has since declined rather sharply. All during this time, while the vaping rate has gone up, the smoking rate has continued to go down and is now at about 1.9%, the lowest rate in the history of this survey. You can also see that the smoking rate in high school students has been extended onto the smoking rate in young adults. Traditionally, historically, young adults have had high smoking rates, but you can see by this graph from our National Health Interview Survey that the smoking rate among young adults has plummeted and is now down around 7.5%. And it's even declined faster during the past 10 years while e-cigarettes.
电子烟开始已经上市了，所以说青少年的吸烟率又在持续下降。那我们必须要提醒各位的就是，我们这里看的数据是来自于青少年烟品调查。好，您如果看到左边这里，这个是2018年的青少年烟品调查。那根据这个调查，他估计说有229万的青少年有吸烟。可是我们如果说看其他的调查，就会发现说 NYTS， 也就是美国青少年烟品调查，它的估计数字都是比较高的。但是我们如果看其他的调查，也就是所谓的知识结构图这样的调查，那根据两个独立研究，其实就会发现说他们的估计吸烟人口都是比较低的。可是美国联邦政府用的是 NYTS 美国青少年烟品调查，那用这个调查的话就会给一个比较高的吸烟人口估计数字。
2021, last year, as I said, the data has just been released, so this is brand new information. There were about 1.7 million high school students who had used e-cigarettes in the past month. As I said, this is down from a high in the higher 2 million just 2 years before. Now, another thing that our federal officials don't mention when they talk about this epidemic is that many of these students also use other tobacco products. They're not necessarily starting with these cigarettes. And in fact, in 2021, about half a million had already used other tobacco products. That leaves about 1.2 million students who had not used any other products. 732,000 school vapers, 732,000 of them had vaped only from 1 to 19 days in the past month. In other words, These students vaped infrequently. They vaped at parties, they vaped at other events. They weren't consistent vapers. But 467,000 did vape 20 plus days during the past month. And in fact, that's worrisome. That means that those individuals may have been they may have been addicted. And so we have to be concerned about nicotine addiction, in fact, addiction for, in any form among high school students. Now, but it's good to keep in mind that that number represents only 3% of the 15 million students in American high schools. It is a relatively low number. It is not the rampant epidemic that our federal officials are indicating in their reports. Now, as Dr. Mendelsohn said, nicotine is not a dangerous substance. especially when it's not used in conjunction with burning tobacco and inhaling smoke. Our federal officials are obsessed with any form of nicotine use, but they are ignoring other much more harmful behaviors and actions that high school students are commonly encountering. You can see a list here of many other activities that are far more frequent and far more dangerous that are being sacrificed. Their attention is being sacrificed by this obsession with teen vaping. Now, another item that has not been at all, it's been ignored, is that vaping by high school students, the majority of them are also vaping marijuana. It's an entirely different usage pattern. It takes different hardware. It's a different liquid. It has nothing to do with nicotine vaping. But unfortunately, the National Youth Tobacco Survey does not make a clear distinction between nicotine and marijuana vaping. So these two behaviors are lumped together. And in fact, that lumping has become a major problem with the emergence in 2019 of the lung diseases in the US that were entirely due to contaminated THC liquid, but in fact were blamed on commercial e-cigarettes. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Professor Rodu. Moving to our next speaker, if we could ask Professor Kai Zhen to actually speak. So we're changing the order slightly from what I announced earlier.
Good morning, everyone. It's my honor, it's my great honor to be here. And thank you for having me here, have an opportunity to share my personal opinions. So in Taiwan, we are about to revise our Tobacco Hazard Prevention Act. In Chinese, in Mandarin, it's 烟害防治法. So on January 13th this year, the Executive Yuan, 行政院, passed the draft amendment to the Tobacco Hazard Prevention Act prepared by the Ministry of Health and Welfare, 卫福部, 卫生福利部. Okay, so yeah. We are about to revise this.
我们即将进行烟害防治法的修法，为什么要修法呢？简单来说。 烟害防治法有非常多的法条，我们今天没有办法一一。We
will define e-cigarettes, or you will say ENDS or ENNDS. We will define e-cigarettes as tobacco-like products, or you can say products imitating tobacco. So we will define ENDS, ENNDS as tobacco-like products, and we are going to ban tobacco, we are going to ban e-cigarette in Taiwan. This is a draft amendment to the Tobacco Hazard Prevention Act. Okay, so you may ask for what reason there are, in brief, there are six reasons. First, the number one cause of death among children under the age of five is air pollution and respiratory infection caused by secondhand smoke. This is the first reason. I will comment this reason later. And the second reason is about 27,000 people die from smoking in Taiwan every year. And the economic cost attributable to smoking disease over the age of 35 years, about 144.1 billion, accounting for about 1% of our national GDP. And the third reason is WHO COP6 recommend that parties consider banning or appropriate regulating nicotine and the non-nicotine electronic delivery systems. That's the third reason. The fourth reason is COP7. The WHO COP7 recommends that parties consider banning or appropriately regulating the manufacture, import, sell, display, or use of ENDS or ENDS. And the fifth reason is heated tobacco products. Tobacco products, meaning that that FCTC fully applies to these products. I mean, the heated tobacco products is a kind of tobacco products, but ENDS, ENDS is not tobacco products. So this is the fifth reason. And the last reason is, according to Taiwan Youth Smoking Behavior Survey in 2019, the e-cigarette use rates among junior high school and senior high school. In Taiwan, junior high school is about age between 12 and 15. And senior high school student is about 15 to 18. That's in Taiwan. And they say, according to this survey, we say the junior high school students, the use rate is about 2.5%. And for senior high school students, the use rate is about 5.6%. It is about e-cigarette. So there have been about 57,000 teenagers are using e-cigarette in Taiwan. So our government think this is a big problem in Taiwan. And also there have been many cases of lung injury and death caused by e-cigarette in the world, indicating that such products need to be strictly regulated. Okay, so according to these six reasons, the Taiwan government, we are about to ban e-cigarette, and we want to define e-cigarette as a tobacco-like products. Okay, here is my comment. For the reason one, I think, air pollution and secondhand smoke, they are harmful materials. Yes, we agree, because there are so many epidemiological studies say there is the association between air pollution and lung cancer, etc. And there's also epidemiology to report the association between the secondhand smoke and the lung cancer, etc. But e-cigarette, I think in England or maybe in US and in some other country, there are studies show the association between smoke cessation or quit smoke among smoker and the e-cigarette. So I think we need more study to do this topic. And for second, talk about the 27,000 people die from smoking. Yeah, so there are conventional tobacco, there are heated tobacco products, and there are also e-cigarette in Taiwan. So why we control, why we regulate conventional products, from conventional tobacco, we will regulate heated tobacco product, but we will ban e-cigarette. So we need more strong evidence, we need more strong reason to do this. And for third and fourth reason about the COP6 and COP7, I think WHO recommend that parties can either consider ban or maybe appropriately regulate. So we still need more discussion, right? But we decide to ban e-cigarette. Yeah. And for the final reason, according to the Taiwan Youth Smoking Behavior Survey in 2019, it says that e-cigarette has higher using rate among senior high school and junior high school. But to be honest, for the conventional cigarette, the use rate of conventional tobacco products among junior high school and senior high school are 3% and 8% respectively. So to be honest, the majority is still a conventional cigarette. So this reason, yes, there seems there is a growing use rate about the e-cigarette among junior high school and senior high school. But still, the conventional tobacco products is still the major tobacco products among Taiwan junior high school students and senior high school students. So I think I agree we have to revise our Tobacco Hazard Prevention Act, but I hope we can revise this act based on strong scientific evidence and also the logical amendment. If we want to revise our regulation, it should be logical and reasonable, and it's possible. Because if we just ban, if possible, we hope we can ban everything in Taiwan, then Taiwan will be a non-tobacco product country. That's idea, but in fact, in real world, it's very difficult. So we prefer, I personally prefer regulate, maybe restrict and limit, but not just ban, because we need more education, we need more research, we need more discussion, and then we revise our act. I think that would be the best policy for Taiwan's people, for our government, and also for all of our sellers. That's my personal presentation and my comment. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And now moving on to our final speaker, Professor Yuan. Thank you.
各位大家好，那很高兴。
It is my pleasure to be invited to this seminar, talking about harm reduction in Taiwan. As previous speakers mentioned, including KJ, they've talked about the international perspective as well as the situation in Taiwan. Here I will give you some stats, some numbers to give you a better idea of the situation in Taiwan. First of all, regarding tobacco harm reduction, based on 2020 data, let's first talk about adults 18 years old and older. About 13% of them are smokers. Compared to 10 years ago, that is already down by 7%. And male smoker percentage has gone down more significantly, whereas female smoker percentage has not moved a lot. Right now, the breakdown between male and female smokers is quite equal. If you talk about males, the male smoker percentage has gone down by 12% over the last decade. And there is a 20% difference between male smoker and female smoker. Now let's talk about age. This is also very interesting. Right now in Taiwan, according to survey results, most male smokers are in the age bracket of 46 to 50 years old. They account for 22% of the male smokers in Taiwan. Whereas female smokers, mostly there are young smokers in the age bracket of 21 to 25. Looking at the income brackets, high income males tend to be smokers. And there's also a study on ethnic groups. For the Aboriginals in Taiwan, they have higher smoking rate for both men and women. Now, before we talk about e-cigarettes or heated tobacco, let's talk about reducing smoking rates. We need to look at the profiles of smokers to tailor make suggestions for them, especially considering women smokers in Taiwan tend to be young and they may bear children in the future. So when we revise the policy, we also need to think about the targets. Based on OECD statistics in 2018, compared to Western countries, the smoking rate in Taiwan is relatively low. Based on OECD surveys, the smoking rate in Taiwan is lower than the median in the OECD survey. We're talking about adults here. As mentioned, Tobacco Hazards Prevention Act is going to be amended in Taiwan, and the new act will stipulate that only people 20 years old and older can smoke. If we look at smokers and where they get their habits, actually 60% or 70% of them had their first exposure of tobacco products before they were 18. Prior to 18, some of them are already an established smoker, and that accounted for 40% of them. And that percentage goes up to 30% or higher if you're talking about people aged 20 and older. In other words, many people are exposed to tobacco products when they are young. So if that is the case, what kind of products are better for their health? I think it comes down to what's practical. It's very difficult to be tobacco-free entirely in the short term. Given that, if we can encourage people to use less harmful products to replace the highly risky combustible tobacco products, that might be the way to go. And that is why we are having this discussion on e-cigarettes and heated tobacco in Taiwan right now. Based on past surveys, you have to think about heated products as well. According to the draft amendments of Tobacco Hazards Prevention Act, flavor products are going to be banned as well. 40% of teenage smokers, they use flavored products, both girls and boys. Based on these statistics that I just shared with you, covering both adults and teenagers, overall, the smoking rate is coming down in Taiwan. And as Professor Zhuang also talked about, Taiwan is trying to ban e-cigarettes. I think the crux of the issue is that currently in Taiwan, we don't have a good survey covering teenagers, whether they are using e-cigarettes or heated tobacco products. Some people say this is because vaping looks cool, so teenagers will start vaping.
But we also heard previously that nicotine itself is addictive, but it's not a substance that causes the serious health harm. So there are still many issues to be clarified. I think with appropriate control, with more comprehensive survey, for example, so that we get to know how addiction is formed, I think we'll be able to come up with better measures to reduce the harm of tobacco use. In Taiwan, whether we are talking about the Tobacco Hazards Prevention Act or other regulations, e-cigarettes have not been very clearly defined, and there has not been comprehensive scientific research. But now we see that we seem to be moving towards a comprehensive ban on e-cigarettes. In Taiwan's Fengyuan, in central Taiwan, people are also thinking about whether they want to produce heated tobacco products or not. I think either you ban all tobacco products, but if that's not possible, perhaps we should think about alternatives to combustible tobacco products. And this is why we need research into the toxicity of the different types of tobacco products. We should not just move to a comprehensive ban because we are trying to pander to certain groups or just trying to follow what others are doing. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you very much. I know that KJ had to unfortunately leave, but could I ask all of the panelists from the first panel if you could rejoin us? We have are running a few minutes behind schedule, but if we can have the questions and answers. So please send questions. I know a number of you already have it through the chat. I will start though with some questions that you've sent me. And the first one is, what about the unknowns about electronic cigarettes? So we know that the carcinogens are considerably lower that we've measured, but is there an unknown carcinogen or a chemical that could create new risks that we don't know about yet?
Well, I'm happy to have a go at that. With any new product or treatment, we never know what the long-term risks are going to be. And we have to make a decision based on what we do know. And we know a lot about e-cigarettes. We do know that there is a dramatic reduction in toxins, huge reduction in biomarkers, that's the toxins in the body. We know that when people use them, they have improved health. And yes, there may be one day problems that we find out that we don't know about yet, but the risk from that is bound to be far less than anything that tobacco, burnt tobacco can achieve. So yes, there is a possible small risk that we at this stage don't know about, but these products have been widely used for nearly 15 years. And I think the risk of anything substantial is very small.
And I would also add to Dr. Mendelson that of course, there are unknown risks, but as he said, they're very small. What we do know for sure is that smoking kills smokers. And that number is 400,000 in the US right now each year, and it's millions across the globe. We know that for a fact, and it's not appropriate not to offer smokers these vastly safer alternatives.
So I think that's a good point, that the risk of not allowing e-cigarettes is much greater than the risk of allowing them.
Our last speaker mentioned the issue of flavors. What could the other panelists, and perhaps also James, if you want to expand, say what your thoughts are about proposals to ban flavors? Is there any evidence that flavors are more dangerous? And what is the state of evidence to do with flavored for products?
Well, I'm happy to comment on that. Look, flavors are an integral part of vaping, and the research shows that they encourage smokers to make the switch. They increase success rates in switching, and they reduce relapse. There are potential risks with flavors, and that needs to be monitored. But I think over time, we will detect any concerns and we can certainly reduce those risks. But I think to remove flavors, well, the research shows...
我觉得如果说是把这个香味, 把这个口味, 把它去除的话, 其实研究显示, 大家反而会回去抽传统的烟。 好，谢谢。 好, 那 James, 您是不是可以谈谈看
regulations and how the general public also feels about these proposals?
Right, allow me to respond to the issue, to your comments about flavored products. In Taiwan, we are not talking about e-cigarettes with flavors. What we are talking about is that some tobacco sellers actually add flavors to traditional cigarettes. So Taiwan is banning flavored conventional cigarettes. Now, in terms of advocacy groups, I think you probably want to know the kind of influence that they have in our policy making. In Taiwan, we have quite a few very powerful anti-smoking advocacy groups, and they've been trying to influence policy making. So the Tobacco Hazards Prevention Act has been in effect for a long time, but now Taiwan is trying to ban e-cigarettes. But if we are talking about the groups, of course, they are very unhappy about flavored cigarettes. They are very unhappy that heated tobacco products are allowed, whereas e-cigarettes are banned. So many of these groups want to ban both heated tobacco products and also e-cigarettes. But of course, there are also groups trying to get the government to approve the use of e-cigarettes. But what about the general public? I think the vast majority of the public, what they are concerned about is the kind of smell that cigarettes have. So let's not talk about the health impact of e-cigarettes. I think that's another issue, but many people don't like the smell of conventional cigarettes, especially people who don't smoke. They don't want to inhale secondhand smoke. They don't like the smell. But e-cigarettes don't tend to create such a strong smell. So it seems to me that the general public are more accepting. So that's my two cents.
And are there any secondhand issues with e-cigarette smoke that it can cause health problems for other people that we know of?
Well, there's no evidence of any harm so far. And that's because the amount of chemicals released into the air by an electronic cigarette is far less than what it is from smoke, but also, of course, it's much less toxic. So, and the smell is not unpleasant. And I think part of the issue is that vapors need to just observe the etiquette they normally would observe with smoking by not vaping around people and keeping away from children. And that would minimize any public concern. Although there's a lot of misinformation in by the public who are concerned about what looks like smoke. And they do need to understand that it is actually so far not been shown to be harmful.
I think that's all the time we have for our first panel. So thank you very much to our four panelists. So thank you very much for joining us. We really appreciate it. I would now like to introduce to who'll be moderating our second panel, Lorenzo Montanari. Lorenzo is Executive Director of the Property Rights Alliance here in Washington, D.C. He's also the Vice President of International Affairs at Americans for Tax Reform. He has a lengthy track record and experience in these issues and in also developing sound public policy around the world. So thank you very much, Lorenzo.
Thank you so much, Tim, and great thanks to the previous speaker for the outstanding presentation and works supported by solid data. We are moving, as you said, to the second part of the webinar, focused on tobacco harm reduction international best practices. At the end of the presentation, we will have, of course, space for Q&A. I'm Loretta Montanari, I'm Executive Director of Property Rights Alliance, an international research and advocacy organization founded in 2005, with a main goal to promote innovation, free market, intellectual property right, and free trade. Strong legal and political environment that recognize and enforce property right, preserve the tangible and intangible asset of inventors while incentivizing innovation. Every year, a Property Rights Alliance published two international reports, the International Property Rights Index and the Trade Barrier Index, authored by our colleagues, Philip Thompson. We have a great panel today with a great policy expert on innovation, free market and harm reduction. International panel, as this webinar is, we have Dr. Carmelo Ferlito from Malaysia, Mr. Yuya Watase from Japan, and Louis Holbrook from New Zealand. And I want to move directly to our first speaker, Dr. Carmelo Ferlito. He's a PhD economist and the CEO of the Center for Economic Education in Kuala Lumpur, Malaysia. This Center of Economic Education sponsors academic initiative for students and professionals who wish to better understand how economics affect their daily life. Dr. Ferlito is author of several books on economics, and today he will be presenting one of the policy papers that we've been publishing as a PRA in partnership with his think tanks on international best practices for tobacco and nicotine public policy in Asia. And this also policy paper has been co-authored by Professor Adam Hoffer. Carmelo, the floor is yours.
Thank you. Thank you, Lorenzo, and thanks to the organizers for having invited me to share some thoughts on harm reduction. Let me open my presentation. Some thoughts on harm reduction that are based on considerations that can be drawn from economic theory, both from a negative and from a positive perspective. So, first of all, a couple of introductory remarks on something that is wrong in, from economic perspective in the current and predominant approach to harm reduction. So the first, probably most important mistake is that current policies based on taxations and prohibition ignore somehow the fact that people choose what are often called sinful behaviors, being aware of the risks that are incurred in these sinful behaviors. And therefore, individuals make their own trade-off analysis. And somehow, with prohibition and taxations, governments are telling that people are not able to choose from themselves. And potentially, these kind of restrictions can be extended to every other kind of behavior, can be even following a certain ideology or watching certain movies. As economist Ludwig von Mises explained more than half a century ago. Another point that I want to make is the point of externalities or social cost. Traditional welfare economics tend to make a choice between the part that need to be punished and the part that need to be protected. So in harm reduction strategy, traditional welfare economics would say that smokers are producing externalities on non-smokers and therefore they have to be penalized because of this bad behavior. But as Nobel laureate Ronald Coase pointed out, externalities should be looked at from a double perspective. So it is true that non-smokers produce externalities on the smokers produce externalities on non-smokers, but by punishing the smokers, we are producing an externality on the smokers. So we are depriving them for their pleasure consumption. So externality analysis needs always to be taken into consideration from the double perspective and try to find a balance on protecting both the rights of both parties, and also considering that what is usually called social cost is very difficult to be measured first. And traditional welfare economics assume that by putting a certain tax on a certain item, we are able to cover exactly the additional cost. And this is a presumption of knowledge that is probably difficult to be proved in reality, so that a certain amount of tax can indeed cover a certain amount of social cost that can indeed be precisely measured. So these are all economic theory problems that need to be somehow considered from a different perspective. Few words on taxation. Taxation on sinful products violate both horizontal inequality and vertical equality. Horizontal because you are taxing in a different way a certain amount of money spent just because it's spent in a certain way, and vertically because it has been proved that addictive products obviously are inelastic, and therefore taxation on this kind of products is regressive and harming more the poor over the rich. And here in our in our paper, we also produce.
在我们的论文里面，我们就有这张图表，看到烟品消费跟收入比例之间的关系。 不过呢，其实税务部分还有更多值得讨论的所谓罪恶税。 大家可能利益良善，也就是希望减少这些产品的消费，但光是利益良善是不够的。我们提高税负或是税率，其实只是加助长黑市。我这边有来自马来西亚的例子，烟税越是提高，非法烟品的比例就越高。 那么马来西亚现在可以说是非法烟品已经来到市面流通烟品的70%，也就是说，对抗烟品的战争在马来西亚其实并没有真的减少烟害，只是造福了烟品的走私商，而消费者使用到的、接触到的就是比较不好的产品。这对于政府来说也不是好事，因为消费者去买这些黑市的烟，政府也征不到税收。那这其实。
We believe that harm reduction policies should use rewards and incentive rather than punishment. It should focus on, yes, decreasing consumption, but decreasing consumption for additive products is more easy to be obtained by shifting consumption towards less harmful products rather than bringing the consumption of pleasure to zero. So the key point that we try to make in our point is not that we should move away people from consuming pleasure, but moving people toward the consumption of pleasure in less harmful ways. And the best way to achieve this is to stimulate innovation and research. The best way in turn to stimulate innovation and research is to create an environment that is conducive to research and innovation through tax incentives, but in particular through an institutional framework that promotes liberty, that promotes freedom of research, that promotes the emergence of entrepreneurship in the country. And this is, of course, a complex discussion, but in a nutshell, an environment that is conducive to innovation is the best environment to produce best way for people to consume pleasure. And this is the direction where we have to go in order to get human progress, economic growth, and finally, harm reduction. So I hope that I was able to stay within the minutes that were allocated to me, and I will be happy to further exploit the topics and the argument that I made during the question and answer session. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Carmelo, for your rigorous analysis and for your leadership on this topic in Malaysia. Now we want to invite Yuyo Batase to discuss harm reduction lifestyle. Yuyo Batase is the chairman of the Pacific Alliance Institute and a researcher at the Waseda University in Tokyo. He's a prominent media pundit on Japanese television and a newspaper and magazine. He's also worked in the past as a campaign advisor and strategist. Mr. Batase is also the co-founder of the Japan-US Innovation Summit, the biggest free market conference in Japan. Yuya, before introducing and giving the floor to you for your presentation, we're going to show the video on harm reduction lifestyle in Japan.
Yep. Good morning and good evening, everyone. Yuya Watase, Pacific Alliance Institute from Japan. We would like to introduce a development of lifestyle that promotes harm reduction. This project is being promoted as a project of Liberal Democrats Party Parliamentary Caucus, led by Mr. Mineyuki Fukuda, a former deputy minister of the cabinet office. My presentation introduces their views on the Japanese situation. The direction of Japan. Japan's harm reduction policy, including tobacco, is beginning to become a unique rule of health and productive management. In Japan, longevity concerns such as social security and the problem in old age are increasing, which has led to dissatisfaction with politics. Health and productivity management is a method to eliminate this anxiety. Health and productive management is intend to reduce the difference between life expectancy and healthy life expectancy. In addition, health and productivity management protects the health of employees, which respects the human rights of employees. I believe this will also lead to an effective approach to countering authoritarian countries by becoming an international rule on the asset. On the idea of health and productive management, it will be one of the solutions to economic security issues. We have prepared a video that expresses our concept. Please watch the video first. Please, Lorenz.
長寿の時代、社会保障費の増加や老後の問題など、長寿不安という問題が深刻化しています。さらに長寿不安は政府への不満となって増幅し、経済や社会生活の安定を揺るがす国政問題へと変化してきています。これは多くの先進国において顕在化している問題で、新たな経済安全保障上の課題といえるでしょう。日本ではこの課題を解決するために、健康経営という日本独自の新しい秩序のルール化が始まっています。この健康経営は、平均寿命と健康寿命の差をできるだけ縮め、不安のない健康長寿社会の実現を目指す上で有効なルールといえます。経済安全保障の議論の高まりを受けて、昨今人権問題が政策上重要になりつつあることから、従業員の健康維持を促し、基本的な人権を尊重する健康経営は、権威主義国に対する人権外交としても価値を持つはずです。つまり健康経営の国際ルール化は、経済安全保障上の課題解決とともに、日本のプレゼンスを高める有効な手段となるのではないでしょうか。この日本独自の健康経営において重要な役割を担っているのが定期健康診断です。日本の健康診断では、健康寿命を低下させ生活習慣病を引き起こす行動として、健康診断5項目を設定しています。 食事、飲酒、睡眠、運動、喫煙です。これらをコントロールすることが生活習慣病リスクを減らし、健康寿命を最大化することにつながりますが、ついつい続けてしまう生活習慣を変えていくことはそう簡単ではありません。そこで注目されているのがハームリダクションライフスタイルです。ハームリダクションライフスタイルとは、ハームリダクションプロダクトを利用して生活習慣病を引き起こすリスクを無理なく低減する生活スタイルです。例えば特歩です。好きな食事と一緒に特歩を飲むことで血糖値の上昇や過度の脂肪の吸収を防ぎ、生活習慣病を引き起こすリスクを低減してくれます。このようにハームリダクションプロダクトを日常生活の中に一定量取り入れることで、ストレスなく生活習慣病の発症を防ぐ、これがハームリダクションライフスタイルなどです。それでは具体的にハームリダクションライフスタイルの例を見てみましょう。通勤、運動ゲームアプリで楽しく徒歩を増やす。昼食、アプリで健康メニュー選び、特歩飲料が脂肪の吸収を抑える。会食では脂肪吸収抑制サプリと血圧を抑える特歩の栄養ドリンク。就寝前なのでカフェインレスコーヒーと加熱式タバコでリラックス。このように生活は変わりなく、ハームリダクションプロダクトを消費します。ハームリダクションライフスタイルが全国民に浸透すれば、おのずと健康寿命は伸びることでしょう。例えば150円の商品を 5% 値引きすると、およそ2割の行動変容が見込めるという学術的な研究結果があります。そこで国が中心となり、生活におけるハームリダクションプロダクトの選択量を2割以上にする行動変容のルール形成を目指してみてはどうでしょうか。これがハームリダクションライフスタイル政策です。さらなる行動変容のアプローチとして、税制を活用することも選択肢の一つと言えるでしょう。そしてハームリダクションライフスタイル政策は、大きな経済効果とイノベーションの促進をもたらします。多数の国内の関連企業、団体がメリットを享受できます。デジタル化による健康データ活用は、健康診断の低コスト化にもつながります。このようなイノベーションの実現のためには、国民がシームレスにデータを活用できるプラットフォームを用意することが不可欠です。プラットフォームの運用においては、マイナンバーの活用も有効です。このようにハームリダクションライフスタイルを取り入れた健康経営のルール化は、不安のない健康長寿社会の実現のために健康寿命を最大化します。長寿大国である日本がいち早くこのルールを導入して長寿不安を払拭できれば、世界各国から注目され、新秩序としての国際ルール化が望まれることになるでしょう。これは日本のプレゼンスを高め、新たな市場を創造する絶好のチャンスなのではないでしょうか。
Thank you, Lorenz.
Thank you, Yuya, for your wonderful video. I think this harm reduction lifestyle should be definitely replicated as a policy all over the world.
The key concept is reducing the risk is the harm reduction lifestyle. The way to do this is to actively utilize harm reduction products. Instead of easily banning existing products, the point is to extend healthy life expectancy by using HRP without changing the lifestyle other than, for example, commuting using the exercise game app, selecting a health menu in lunch by app, healthy promoting beverages suppress fat absorption, consumption of fat absorption suppression supplements and blood pressure suppressing beverage and at dinner, and relaxing with caffeine-less coffee and heating a cigarette before going to bed. Therefore, it is possible to form rules aimed at promoting policies that promote behavioral change with a selection amount of more than 20% of who have HRP. In Japan, the tobacco tax was raised on October 1 last year. However, there is a big difference in the amount of price increase between traditional cigarette and heating cigarettes. If a person who smokes a cigarette box a day switch to heating cigarette, he can save almost $1,000 per year. Currently, the use of heating cigarettes is promoted by different in the tax increase tax rate, but it is possible to further promote the use of heating cigarettes by reducing tax on it. At the political level, rule-forming strategy caucus of the Liberal Democrats Party is examining the rule-building of health and management. We see it as an opportunity for Japan, a long-rivaled country, to increase the presence and create new markets by making rules faster than the other countries. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Yuya, for your leadership on that, and really we appreciate your presentation, the video. We are now moving to Louise Hulbrook, that we conclude this discussion, this session on lesson learned in New Zealand. Louise Hulbrook is the campaign manager for the New Zealand Taxpayer Union. He's execute campaign and ensure that the voice of New Zealand taxpayer heard in radio, television, social media, newspaper across the country. He's the co-author of the policy paper that we've been publishing as a PRA recently, Vaping Works International Best Practices, and United Kingdom, France, Canada, and New Zealand. And Louise will be focused on the New Zealand section. This policy paper has been co-authored with Christopher Snowden, Professor Jan Irvine, and Patrick Cockwart. Louise, the floor is yours.
Hello, thanks for having me. Now, I'm from the Taxpayers Union, so I guess the question is, why is a taxpayers group interested in harm reduction? The answer in New Zealand is because of the extremely high excise tax rate on tobacco in New Zealand. Even a cheap packet of cigarettes in New Zealand costs around 21 American dollars. So we see the financial harm caused by these taxes as a form of tobacco harm, in addition to the health harms that we all know about. So our tax rates are so high in New Zealand, we've seen a thriving black market with smuggled cigarettes. I'm just bringing it up on my screen. You can see a selection of photos of police seizures of cigarettes. And we have also seen an explosion of robberies, often violent robberies of the shops that sell tobacco. So we see vaping as a way for smokers to escape not just health harms, but also financial harms, but also for New Zealand and other countries to escape from the social harms and the crime that has formed around tobacco. So in New Zealand, our government has actually accidentally legalized vaping and heated tobacco products. This happened in 2018 when our Ministry of Health challenged Philip Morris and argued in court that heated tobacco products were illegal under our existing law. However, the judge found that it would contradict the purpose of our tobacco control laws to ban heated tobacco products, because our tobacco laws are focused on reducing harm. So as a result of that decision from that judge, both heated tobacco and vaping products became legal without regulation. So for about 2 years, we had this unregulated interregnum for vaping products. And you can see the result with the image I'm sharing on my screen, which shows the top line being our smoking rate and the bottom line being our vaping rate. As you can see, smoking has now reduced to 9.4% prevalence. where vaping has increased to 6.2% prevalence. Interestingly, this has happened not just after the government legalized vaping products, but also after the government stopped increasing the tax on tobacco. So this improvement in our situation cannot be attributed to tobacco tax. The obvious answer is that this correlation that you see is in fact a causation, and smokers are switching to vaping. Now, how did we get to this point politically? Aside from the government initially accidentally legalizing vaping products, they have since formalized the laws. They have regulated but still permitted vaping products to be sold fairly accessibly. Most convenience stores in New Zealand, you can go in and buy vaping products. The reason the government has taken a permissive stance on these products, I think, is really due to the frontline workers and quit smoking groups, and also former smokers themselves, who've shared their testimonies of how they have benefited from the availability of vaping products. Eventually, the evidence just became too difficult for the academics to deny. So our public health groups are now advocating for harm reduction. And even our government now promotes vaping as a way to quit smoking. So the page that I'm currently sharing is a Ministry of Health website. And as you can see, it says, vaping can help you quit smoking. Vaping is less harmful than smoking. These are official government messages promoted widely in New Zealand. And additionally, even our politicians, including our Prime Minister Jacinda Ardern, now acknowledge that vaping is making a difference in terms of our decreasing smoking rate. So I know a lot of people internationally like to quote Jacinda Ardern. So if you want to quote Jacinda Ardern, please quote her on vaping. It's right there. What I would say is that it would be a mistake to hold up New Zealand as a bastion of freedom or a bastion of progressive, open-minded policy. Our government is still fundamentally prohibitionist, I would say, in its instincts. For example, on tobacco, it is currently advancing a proposal to reduce the nicotine content in cigarettes by 95%. So our positive outcomes with vaping are in spite of, not because of, the attitudes of our government. But I hope that does send a message of hope to other countries. You may feel as though your government has a closed-minded view on vaping or heated tobacco. However, again, as I say, as long as those former smokers can be heard, as long as their voices are amplified, at some point you will see a turnaround on policy. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Luis. We are running behind time, so I get some questions for our speakers. So the first one is for Carmelo. Since you mentioned the illicit trade, there is a question that in the country that have banned this product, what is the effect on the illicit trade after the ban? Can you articulate a little bit more?
Yeah, I think that the basic consideration that we have to do with this is that human beings are interested in pleasure. Okay. So we are pleasure consumers. We look for pleasure. It's part of our human behavior. So all the, actually this is in the history of mankind, all the attempts of forbidding the consumption of pleasure results in the growth of illicit consumption of pleasure. This is regarding the consumption of sex, the consumption of tobacco, the consumption of alcohol. And so the all the prohibitions or taxations, regulations, they just go in the direction of denying human nature, which is a pleasure seeker. So humans are pleasure seekers. So whenever we try to forbid pleasure consumption, we have a growth in the illicit consumption of pleasure, which is, by the way, a less safe consumption of pleasure, and also a fiscal harm for government pockets. So in a nutshell, the ultimate result is not a reduction of consumption of pleasure, but driving consumers toward the consumption of the same pleasure in an illicit way.
Thank you, very clear. We have another question for Luis regarding New Zealand has recently adopted the tobacco harm reduction as part of its tobacco control strategy, as you mentioned. So what does that look like in terms of specific policy and regulation for reduced risk nicotine product? And what has the impact been in terms of smoking rate?
Sure. We are relatively permissive compared to most other countries. Like I said, most convenience stores, you can buy vaping products. You can also buy heated tobacco products. One unfortunate restriction we do have is on the availability of flavors. So I can get tobacco or I can get menthol flavored e-cigarettes at my local convenience store. But if I want a berry flavor or a melon flavor or a cookies and cream flavor, I have to go to a specialist vape store. That's not such an issue in the big cities, but some of our highest smoking rates actually occur outside of our cities, in regional New Zealand and rural New Zealand, where smokers are being denied access to flavors that we know are extremely helpful for quitting. So we still see higher smoking rates in those lower income, more regional and rural areas.
Okay, thank you. Last question for Yuya. In Japan and Korea, since the tobacco heated products are legal, so no additional market approval is required. How has this policy helped smokers to embrace a harm reduction lifestyle? And do you have any data proving the health status of the switch smoker users? You need to mute yourself, Yuya.
Okay. There were new survey published last year. Japan Tobacco announced on April 22 last year at the online conference on scientific findings on THP. They published the study report comparing THP and traditional cigarettes, amount of substance of health concern taken into the body. Adult cigarette smoker who are judged to be in good health by medical institution. 15 people each, four types of THP, including Palm Tech Plus, Palm S2, etc. After switching to the use of one of the heating cigarette, continuing to smoke cigarettes, or quitting the smoke for 5 days, the study HM investigated the exposure of health-related substance by collecting urine and measuring breath. They also investigated the daily tobacco usage and nicotine exposure as a usage of these tobacco products. This survey was conducted by a medical institution after obtaining approval for implementation by the Ethics Review Committee of the medical institution. The study revealed many of the health findings measured in the group. The switches from the cigarette to four type of THP, the exposure has been reduced to the same level as a quiet smoking group. Also a marked reduction in exposure to many of the measured health concerns when compared to the group who continue to smoke cigarettes. Also, it is possible to conclude the equal and the THP has a less health risk from the survey alone. It can be regarded as an important basis of important basis for being a risk reduction product. We continue to check the survey and continue to research more. Thank you.
Thank you, Yuya. Thank you so much to Carmelo Ferlito, Yuva Tazen, Luis Holbrook for your outstanding presentation based on solid data and policy analysis. Just to conclude a little bit, in this panel, we analyzed and we hear about international best practices, mainly focused on Malaysia, Japan, and New Zealand. And the international best practices concerning tobacco and nicotine regulation help to achieve harm reduction and cessation while promoting innovation and guarding against unintended consequences. Several studies, as we show in our presentation, I'm going to share the link in the chat session, estimate that policy recommendations that adhere to the international best practices framework in Asia, for example, will result in more individuals breaking their addiction to tobacco products. So we can conclude that the harm reduction policy should incentivize behavioral change through individual choice instead of a restricting policy intended to harm consumers, such as taxes. We finished the second section and we enter now in the last but not least part of the webinar, focus on how tobacco harm reduction can be embedded into tobacco policymaking. This panel will be moderated by Lindsay Stroud, is the director of the Taxpayer Alliance Consumer Center. Is a center that provides data and analysis to inform and assist policymakers when addressing consumer products. Stroud authored several policy papers, Tobacco Harm Reduction 101, a guidebook for policymakers in 2018, as well as Vaping, E-cigarette, and Public Policy Toward Alternative to Smoking 2017. She's one of the leading experts in harm reduction policy. Lindsay, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Lorenzo. That was a great introduction. I really appreciate it. And thank you, Tim, for having us on here and all of our guests. Thank you for joining us and everybody who's on here attending. It's really great to see all the participation. So we are running late, so I'm just going to go pretty quickly into it. We will be discussing THR and how it's going to fit into policymaking. And we've got some really great guests. Clive Bates is probably sleeping right now as it's 2 a.m. in the UK. And you've got probably know him from Twitter and everywhere else that he is at. And he's director of Counterfactual Consulting, and he's the longstanding advocate for tobacco harm reduction as a strategy to address the burden of disease and premature death caused by smoking. And he will be joining us with a pre-recorded video. Next, we will have Professor Chi Rui Zia. I probably really completely mispronounced that last name, and I do apologize. He's the adjunct professor at the Fang Xia University, and he's a health economist. And he has significant prior roles that have covered diversified areas, including the field of health economics and applied microeconomics. We have Michelle Mitten. She's a research fellow at the Competitive Enterprise Institute and specialized in regulations related to individual and public health, including food, alcohol, drugs, including nicotine and gambling. And her work centers on how health and policies are created and their effects. Finally, and thank you for coming on such short notice, we have Nancy Lucas. She's the executive coordinator of the Coalition of Asia Pacific Tobacco Harm Reduction Advocates, or CAPFRA. It's a voluntary coalition of 11 consumer THR organizations. They're very active in advocacy as a group supporting the cause and each other's activities. And I guess we're just going to start with Clive Bates's presentation. I think that's going to be working on everybody else's end.
There's a slight technical issue at the moment with pulling it up on screen share, even though we tested it earlier. If you can just give us a moment and if we can just go to Michelle first while we try and...
Okay. Michelle, if you're ready. Thank you.
I'm ready. Well, okay, first of all, thank you so much for inviting me to speak today. It's a great honor, and I will try and cut this a little bit short since I know we're running out of time. So far, a lot of the other panelists have talked about the idea of the continuum of risk when it comes to various nicotine products, and it's quite clear that these novel non-combustible products like e-cigarettes, snus, heated tobacco, et cetera, pose a far less risk to health than combustible tobacco like cigarettes. But of course, less risk is not risk-free, and many countries, including Taiwan, are now facing the question of how public policy can address these low-risk products in order to best protect and promote public health. Now, to date, this public policy debate over nicotine has been framed as a choice between permissive policies versus non-permissive policies or prohibition. In this framing, the supposed choice is between tolerating some degree of risk in order to preserve access to less risky products like e-cigarettes versus the elimination of risk via prohibition. But what I'm going to talk about in my presentation is that this is a false choice. that bans do not eliminate harm because bans do not, and in fact cannot, eliminate demand or markets for products that consumers want. What bans do is redirect demand from a legal market to non-legal markets. And as I'm going to talk about, this can actually escalate rather than reduce harm. So I'm going to begin with a simple truth about public policy that applies universally, frankly, to all countries, all issues, and in every era of human history, which is this: that a policy's ability to achieve its stated objectives is dependent on the level of compliance with that policy. Now, what that means functionally is that if people refuse to comply with a policy, it cannot achieve its stated goals. And when policies are less restrictive, people tend to find them easier to comply with. But as they become more restrictive, non-compliance increases. And as non-compliance with a policy increases, that policy becomes not just less effective, but can actually become counterproductive to whatever its goals are as people pursue riskier and riskier means of circumventing the law. Now, to illustrate this somewhat complex sounding point, I'm going to present a few examples of where governments have tried to institute various levels of restrictions for certain products, and then discuss how those restrictions affected consumer behaviors, markets, and the policy's ability to achieve its stated goals. So I'm going to start with Australia, where one of our other speakers, Colin Mendelson, hails from, where at the end of 2021, they enacted a prohibition on the importation of nicotine. Now, prior to this, people could, so e-cigarette sales were legal so long as they didn't contain nicotine, and consumers could tacitly allowed to import nicotine for their own personal use. But citing fears over youth e-cigarette use, the government decided to bar the importation unless a person had a valid prescription, with violators facing up to $200,000 fines, and that's in USD. Now, given that at the time of this prohibition, there were fewer than 30 doctors, I think, in the country that were authorized to prescribe nicotine e-cigarettes, it acted basically as a prohibition. It wasn't just this prescription model that it was sold as. And with several hundred thousand adult vapers throughout the country, demand for nicotine e-cigarettes didn't simply disappear when the new law went into effect. Instead, individual consumers who were previously importing nicotine for their personal use turned to illicit dealers because illicit dealers were more willing to violate the law and take those particular risks. And within a few months, news stories started to appear about Uber drivers, for example, selling disposable nicotine e-cigarettes for $50 each, with similar deals taking place on other social media platforms like Instagram and TikTok. Now, it's too early at this point to say whether the law has had any impact on youth vaping in Australia. What we're seeing is a significant increase in the illicit market for these products in that country. And this market not only lacks guarantees about quality and safety of the products, but it also lacks any enforcement of the existing age restrictions. So that is, it's unlikely that an Uber driver willing to break the law and potentially risk a $200,000 fine in order to sell vapor products to passengers legally would bother then to check the ID of their passengers to make sure that they're over age. So the law designed supposedly to reduce use access to nicotine e-cigarettes may very well inadvertently increase their access to these products. The second example is a little different. It's California here in the US, where they tried to institute regulations on recreational cannabis. Now here, the point was explicitly aimed at creating a safe market where adults could legally purchase cannabis, while the regulations were also meant to discourage youth access to cannabis and to eliminate all of the problems associated with the criminal cannabis market, something that Carmelo previously talked about, the problems with the criminal market. But even while California had legalized cannabis, the regulations proved so strict and costly that the number of legal dispensaries in the state remained relatively small and mostly clustered around a few major cities like LA and San Francisco. And the products they were selling were far more expensive than what consumers could still obtain on the illegal market, which as a result continued to thrive, and estimated now that still about 90% of all the sales of cannabis in California occur in the black or gray markets. And now what this means is that adult cannabis consumers are still not benefiting from the safe and legal market that the state's regulation promised, and youth continue to have access to these products through illicit dealers. Now, the third example, again, comes from America, and this time it's with regard to federal efforts to create an approval process for e-cigarettes. In this case, the Congress gave our FDA the ability to approve or deny e-cigarettes for sale, ostensibly to ensure that the e-cigarettes that were on the market legally were safe for adults and protective of public health. Prior to the deadline for these applications, FDA received about more than 6 million applications from companies who wanted to comply with the regulation. But after several years, the FDA has approved only three products, all made by one tobacco giant, RJ Reynolds, and has also issued blanket denials for thousands of small and mid-sized vapor companies. Often these denials coming for their applications failing to include materials the FDA explicitly told them they did not need to include. Furthermore, the FDA has signaled that it will deny all applications for non-tobacco flavored e-cigarette products, despite there being no rule or scientific logic behind that decision. Now, it seems to be the FDA's hope that by refusing to approve any flavored e-cigarettes and by refusing all but a handful of devices, that the rest of the products that are on the market will simply disappear, eliminating the harm that these products supposedly pose, particularly to youth. But that's not what's happening, and that's not what is going to happen. So facing a de facto prohibition, the industry, which had previously sought to comply with the regulations, began to pursue legal loopholes, for example, by replacing tobacco-derived nicotine with synthetic nicotine. And the reason they did that is because until very recently, a U.S. statute only gave FDA the power to regulate tobacco products and products containing nicotine derived from tobacco. Now, synthetic nicotine has been around for a long time, but e-cigarette companies chose not to use it, mostly because it was too expensive. The only reason that they have now chosen to pursue synthetic nicotine, the loophole, is because the FDA made it clear that there was no viable path for companies to comply with the existing regulatory regime, and companies saw this as their last option to remain on the market without operating completely illegally. Now, since just in the last month, our Congress passed a law giving FDA the power to regulate and prohibit synthetic nicotine in e-cigarettes. Again, the hope is that these products will simply disappear once this loophole is closed. But from what we've already seen, this isn't what is going to happen. Even before the FDA began soliciting applications for approvals from e-cigarettes, several states had already instituted their own flavor bans on e-cigarettes. And what happened in the aftermath of those prohibitions, such as in San Francisco, which eliminated all e-cigarettes for sale, and in Massachusetts, which eliminated flavored e-cigarettes, we saw a flood of smuggled and counterfeit knockoff products coming from other states and overseas. Now, these knockoff products that began to flood into the market, they not only pose whatever risks are supposedly associated with flavored e-cigarettes, but they also contain the additional hazards associated with products produced by unlicensed and unaccountable manufacturers. This means that not only are flavor bans or e-cigarette bans failing to accomplish the goal of eliminating youth access or eliminating supposedly harmful products, but by pushing consumers and markets toward greater degrees of non-compliance with the rules, they're actually maximizing the harm of these products. So what all these examples illustrate is that simple universal truth that I mentioned at the beginning, which is that a policy's ability to achieve its goals depends on compliance. No matter how noble its goals may be, it will never achieve them and will produce unintended negative consequences if people cannot or will not comply with it. The fact of the matter is simply that there is a demand for nicotine in Taiwan and the rest of the world, and no amount of regulation can eliminate that demand. All it can do is direct how that demand is satisfied. And now this is where harm reduction comes in. And Taiwan, in fact, already has experience with this principle. Now I want to show one quick slide. It's the only slide that I'm going to use. So let's see, can I share my screen? Well, there it is, if it'll stay there. So back in around 2004, Taiwan experienced a massive spike in HIV transmission stemming from injectable drug use. Now that's that red line that you see spiking up around 2005. Now, of course, injectable drugs like heroin were already prohibited under the law, with dealers facing sentences of up to life in prison for selling heroin. But clearly the prohibition didn't eradicate the sale or the use of these drugs. Rather than pursuing the hopeless path of greater degrees of enforcement of the prohibition, the Taiwanese government established a harm reduction pilot program in a few cities. This included expanded education, access to testing, and the somewhat controversial steps of offering access to clean needles and opioid replacement therapies. In some places, they even have clean needle vending machines, like the one that I have pictured later in my presentation, but you're not going to see that. So now, once the program was adopted nationally in 2006, the results were astoundingly successful, astoundingly. As you can see, the nationwide harm reduction program for HIV related to injectable drugs, it reduced the transmission of HIV from injectable drugs in just a few years down to where it was back pretty much in 2002. That is amazing. Though there were concerns that the program would, you know, seem to be condoning injectable drug use and make it attractive to non-users or youth, the government in Taiwan focused on the biggest problem, took the harm reduction approach, and succeeded in rapidly improving the public health situation in their country. Now, in addition to this harm reduction program, the government also began to treat the opioid replacement therapies more leniently than heroin. They have their own schedules where heroin is treated most harshly, where something like methadone is treated more leniently. Now, if we look to see what's happening with smoking, it's kind of a similar thing that's happening. As somebody else mentioned in a previous panel, 20,000 Taiwanese people still die every year from smoking-related diseases. I think that's about 50-some-odd people every single day die from smoking. And e-cigarette use, while it is on the rise, is still practically non-existent among adults and very low among youth. This isn't to say that e-cigarette use by young people who've never smoked or would never have smoked isn't worthy of attention, but the policy approach to this issue must be very carefully crafted. It must account for the effects of the policy on both youth and adults, and it must weigh how the policy might alter vaping and smoking behaviors. And above all, it has to consider the costs of trying to enforce that policy. Now, bans, taxes, and even extremely harsh penalties have done little to stop the illicit trade of tobacco or drugs around the world. And it's not only an enormous loss of revenue to the governments when they fail to be able to enforce these, which they never will be able to do, but it also puts consumers at risk when they are functionally forced into the illicit market where products could be of any quality, could be adulterated, and there's no way to really hold these companies accountable. So with all of this said, I just want to really stress that Taiwan should not follow the foolish example of countries like the US or countries like Australia by banning flavored e-cigarettes or banning e-cigarettes entirely. And they shouldn't listen to billionaires or Western charities telling them that prohibition will work and eliminate the risks of nicotine use. They should replicate the success that they had with drugs harm reduction and institute risk relative regulation for nicotine products. So make the harshest regulations for the most dangerous products like cigarettes and have more lenient, more easy to comply with regulations for the lower risk products that are such as non-combustible products. In this way, you can ensure that youth still don't have access to these products or have a lower access to these products, but that they are still available for consumers who wish to, so that consumers who wish to use nicotine, adult consumers still have the safest and least harmful options available to do that, still have the least harmful options available to them. So thank you very much for your time and attention.
Thank you so much, Michelle. That was really informative. I didn't really know that about the HIV and harm reduction over in Taiwan. I do believe that we are ready for Clive Bates' video.
Good morning, everybody. My name is Clive Bates from Counterfactual Consulting. My job this morning is to offer 5 insights on embedding tobacco harm reduction in tobacco policy making. These are the 5 insights. The first and most important is to focus on the right goal. And the right goal is the death and disease caused by smoking. Don't need to go into this. We just need to remind ourselves that there's a massive death toll, 8 million a year killed annually by smoking, more than obesity, alcohol, road accidents, drug misuse, and HIV combined. And worldwide, similar to the burden of death from COVID-19, but happening every year, year after year, for multiple decades. Now, there has been good progress on smoking in Taiwan, I'm pleased to say, but even now, there is still just about 1/4 of men are still smoking, and boys will follow them. And they are at risk of losing 10 years of life, one in two will die prematurely, serious risk of cancer and so on. So it's still a very substantial public health problem afflicting one in four men, a much smaller number of women. Second insight is to see innovation as an opportunity. And the big insight here is that people smoke for the nicotine but die from the tar. What's really doing the damage are products of combustion, the particles of sticky burnt tobacco smoke and the toxic gases that are inhaled into the lungs, not the nicotine. The nicotine is the reason why people smoke, but it's not what does the damage. And armed with that insight, we can now look at the pattern of innovation that there has been in the marketplace. We now have vaping products, heated tobacco products, oral nicotine products, and smokeless tobacco products. And they all share one thing in common. They do not involve combustion. They all provide nicotine in a way that smokers find satisfying, but none of them involve combustion, smoke, or products of combustion. And that's the secret to tobacco harm reduction. In the case of vaping, the Royal College of Physicians said that e-cigarettes are unlikely to exceed 5% of the risks associated with smoked tobacco products and may well be substantially lower than this figure. And the reason we know this comes from biomarker data, information on how much toxicants can be found in blood, saliva, and urine. And the studies show that most of the toxicants that are harmful with smoking are either not present or present at much lower levels or the levels that you would find in non-smokers. And that's the basis for our confidence in harm reduction. It's basically an innovation story. Battery energy density now means that we can have compact devices that will heat a liquid using electricity rather than the heat from burning tobacco leaf itself through a combustion process. And that has allowed products that now challenge challenge cigarettes in the marketplace. It's similar in many ways to other energy transitions from the internal combustion engine to electric vehicles and from fossil fuel electricity generation to renewables. And these are all positive innovations and have the effect of reducing risk. In the case of electric vehicles and renewables, they're reducing climate risks. In the case of electronically heated tobacco products and nicotine products, the risk is reduced to health. The next area, the next insight to grasp, I think, is understanding the human behavioral drivers, okay? There's a lot to say about this, but I'll focus on what we know about people substituting vaping and e-cigarettes for smoking and therefore getting a health benefit. The evidence has been summarized by Professor Robert West of the University College London, one of the world's leading authorities on smoking cessation. He says that there is three strands of evidence that concur: randomized controlled trials, observational studies where you follow people using these products and see what they do, and population trends where we see where e-cigarette use has been popular, smoking rates have fallen rapidly. There's also evidence from user testimony, market data, and natural experiments, for example, where prices of cigarettes and e-cigarettes have changed. We can see that one product substitutes for another. Also, it's what you'd expect. We would expect people to switch to products that are cleaner, that use, that come with less stigma, less inconvenience, that are cheaper and so on. So it's not a surprise, any of this. It's exactly what we would expect. There are randomized controlled trials where we see e-cigarettes having twice the effectiveness of traditional smoking cessation treatments, for example. But to get into the meat of this presentation, the key insight from a policymaker's point of view is to beware unintended consequences. Doing things that you think are the right thing to do for e-cigarettes or these other products, but actually ending up with more smoking. And the Royal College of Physicians, again, had a brilliant insight into this that I want to share. This is the text from the report, but I want to break it down in this extract here. Now, if a risk-averse and precautionary approach makes e-cigarettes less easily accessible, less palatable or acceptable, more expensive, less consumer-friendly, pharmacologically less effective, in other words, not as satisfying as cigarettes, or it inhibits innovation, then it causes harm by perpetuating smoking. Basically, the Royal College here recognise if you make life difficult for e-cigarettes, you're making life easy for the cigarette trade. That hasn't stopped there being a major international campaign for prohibition. The union here calling for low and medium income countries, not Taiwan, which is an advanced economy, prohibiting e-cigarettes and heated tobacco product sales. I cannot think of a more terrible idea than to prohibit a much safer alternative to cigarettes than leaving cigarettes on the market. It just makes no sense at all. The effect will be to protect the cigarette trade, to create a black market in e-cigarettes and these other banned products, to engage young people in the illicit supply chain, and to remove the possibility of having good regulatory standards and appropriate fiscal environment. It's a completely mad idea to do this, but nevertheless, it's gaining traction. Don't take my word for it. The World Health Organization examined the ban on tobacco products in Bhutan and concluded that the illicit market was a greater challenge now, that illicit products had grown since the ban on sale in early 2000. And finally, unfortunately, as studies indicate, Bhutanese youth are at the center of this growing illegal trade in tobacco and its products. It's a truly terrible idea. Yet we're seeing this come up in Taiwan now. A proposal from the cabinet in January 2022, and Taipei moving to ban e-cigarettes in November 2021. Do not do this. It's a really terrible idea. You can see what the possible intent, you can imagine that the intended outcome is that the products, when banned, will disappear, and people who are using nicotine, vaping or smoking will just give up completely and do something virtuous instead. In fact, there's a huge range, and I've listed some of them on this chart, of things that people will do instead. They'll buy from the illicit trade, buy from overseas over the internet, they'll go back to smoking, they'll not switch from smoking in the first place, they'll take up smoking instead of vaping, they'll switch to cannabinoids, they'll make their own, and so on. It's not a good policy to do this once you look at how people will actually respond, not how regulators want them to respond. So what is the right way to go about this? I call this risk proportionate regulation. The idea is quite simple. You use the strongest regulation on the most dangerous products. So for cigarettes, you would have high taxes, prohibit advertising, and have strong graphic warnings depicting disease. But for the safer products that are alternatives to cigarettes, you have low or zero tax. You control advertising themes and placement. You don't have a laissez-faire approach, but you don't ban the advertising because that's what encourages people to switch. And instead of gruesome warnings, you have messages encouraging switching. Okay, now you can set up a risk proportionate framework in which you're tough on cigarettes, you're not laissez-faire with the safer products, but you regulate in proportion to risk. And that's the crucial insight. Finally, I want to end with a comment from one of the gurus of innovation, Calestous Juma. Claims about the promise of new technology are at times greeted with skepticism, vilification, or outright opposition, often dominated by slander, innuendo, scare tactics, conspiracy theories, and misinformation. The assumption that new technologies carry unknown risks guides much of the debate, but this is often amplified to levels that overshadow the dangers of known risk. He wasn't talking about smoking, vaping, or nicotine, but he might have been. And that is a very prescient comment for the situation we now find ourselves in. And with these insights, I'm going to close my presentation. I hope that Taiwan will avoid the prohibitionist path and take the risk proportionate path. And I thank you for your attention. And I would now like to switch back to the panel for the rest of the presentation. Thank you very much for your attention.
And we're back. And that was really great from Clive. Now we have Professor Chirui Jia. I'm probably terribly pronouncing that name, and I do apologize.
Okay, hello everyone. It's a great pleasure to present my research idea here. And I am an economist. That's my talk will share some new insight for tobacco policy. And for tobacco policy making from the perspective of economists as well as from the past research experience. The point that I want to emphasize is the transformation of the government role in tobacco policy making from regulator to helper. And let me start, it should be a little bit quick. Let me start from my personal research experience. I began to conduct a series of research related to smoking behavior in early 1990s. At the same time, at that time, the smoking rate for adult male is near 60%. As you can see in this picture, at the beginning, it's near 60%. And now this rate has decreased to about 25%, as you can see from the previous slide presented by Clapet and this slide. And the substantial reduction in smoking rate among adult male is greater success in tobacco control effort, ranging from information provision, regulation, and tobacco tax. And next slide, please. And this long-term trend reducing, this long-term trend in reducing smoking rate raised two interesting questions. The first one I would like to ask is why some smokers quit smoking and others still keep smoking? And the second one I would like to ask is whether the success of the tobacco control policy in the past guarantees the success in the future if we keep moving the same policy forward. Next slide, please. And my presentation will focus on these two questions. First, when we saw many smokers has quit smoking during the past 3 decades, while many others still keep smoking habit, it is natural to ask why some fail to quit. Maybe they do not know the risk of smoking harder. This is unlikely to be true after 3 decades effort on information communication about smoking risk. So the question is why some smokers continue their smoking habit after 3 decades effort for tobacco control. Next slide. I think the recent research on behavior economics offer answer for this question. They found that people want to quit smoking but fail because they have time inconsistent preference, indicating that individuals acquire a high discount rate in the short run than they do in the long run. Next slide, please. A high discount rate would tend to make future costs less important. Thus, the future costs of smoking will loom large in the decision whether or not to smoke tomorrow than it does in the decision about whether to smoke today. Smoker always like to say, I will stop smoking tomorrow. But tomorrow never comes. This means that individual lacks self-control, although they know the risk of smoking. We always enjoy something today and say, I will stop it tomorrow. Based on next slide, based on this research finding, we can conclude that smokers need someone to help them to quit smoking. As the government in Taiwan always say, Taiwan can help. A policy implication from this take-home message is that the goal of tobacco policy making should shift from regulator to helper. So the question, next slide. So the question turned to who can help? I think that the National Health Insurance Program should provide financial incentives for medical providers to offer smoking cessation program and design a new payment system to integrate prevention and treatment. This policy design could serve as a nudge to help smokers to quit. Next slide. Now, let me turn to the second question that I would like to discuss. As you have seen in the long-term trend of declining smoking, Taiwan did a good job in the past. However, the question is whether we can keep winning the battle in the future by adopting the same strategy that we did before. Next slide. I think that the answer is no. Our world is not just a simple linear world, and that we cannot do the same job and yield the same outcome all the time. Why we cannot just follow the same regulation rule as we did in the past? This is because there is a diminishing marginal return for policy, including tobacco policy. In addition, the world is dynamic in the sense that many new products emerge in the market over time. We need to have a new policy when we face a new challenge. For example, if we keep increasing cigarette tax, we will fall into the trap of level code in the sense that a high tax rate will yield a low revenue. In tobacco case, this may be due to the increase in tobacco smoking. Many speakers in this morning mentioned this point, that when government increase the tobacco tax, we see more smuggling activity. So in addition, if we ban new tobacco product, it may just lead to the development of black market. The previous speaker already mentioned this point. So next slide. In conclusion, my point is that the current legislation proposal seems not hit the key point. The policy goal should focus on helping smokers to quit instead of pushing smokers into the corner. In addition, long policy will produce many unintended consequences, such as creating black market and damage the source of government tax revenue. I think that the time is lag behind, so I stop here. Thank you.
So much, Professor. And Nancy did ask to have us just kind of go into Q&A, so can everybody on this panel turn on their cameras and we'll get started on that. And if anybody's got a question, you know, shoot it into the chat. And I do have a few questions that I wanted to ask myself. So I guess we can do this too. Well, I guess everyone can probably answer it. Should Taiwan develop its own health risk assessment system, or simply reference what we do in the United States, the pre-market tobacco applications, the PMTA, or maybe the European Tobacco Product Tax, Products Directive TPD model?
I think they should probably, I think they should probably look to what New Zealand's doing, because even though it's imperfect, as Lewis mentioned, it's working and it doesn't have an onerous administrative burden to it. And it allowed for consumers to be involved in the process, and it allowed for the community itself to help one another to get us beyond the smoking burden. So I would say New Zealand, of course, being a former director of AFCA, of course I would say that, but it worked and it's a small country. And I think that that's probably the easiest, fastest way to get it done.
Yeah, I would reiterate that. And I would just say, absolutely do not look to the United States. No, however well-intentioned the US process was, it is uncompliable, right? It is not a system that is made to work for most of the businesses, except for the very largest tobacco companies. So again, if the goal is to harm big tobacco or keep things off the black market, the American system is just too onerous, too complex, too opaque for companies who've already invested a lot of time and energy only to see what appears to be a complete waste of time and money with the FDA confusingly denying, blanket denying in some cases, a lot of applications. So I would say don't look to the US. It is an unworkable system that is only going to functionally result in a ban with the few largest companies who have, you know, billions of dollars capable of, and who have worked with these regulators for so long. The idea that consumers can have a voice, that marginalized groups can have a voice, you know, native peoples can have a voice, small and mid-sized companies, that would be wonderful. And I think Taiwan should definitely look to itself and try and see what works specifically with their situation and for their people and their specific needs.
Okay, and I think that usually we will learn experience from our neighborhood country. So I think the experience from Japan and New Zealand may be good for us to learn how to do the risk assessment.
Perfect. Great answers from everybody. So when we are talking about harm reduction and talking about tobacco harm reduction, are we looking at, is this going to be a reduction to the smoker or a reduction of harm to the whole society? And how should we think of this in terms of policy making?
I guess I could start out there and answer that it's both, right? So the individual smoker will experience harm reduction if they switch over from a combustible to a non-combustible product, but also society at large, you know, something that other speakers have talked about, the secondhand vapor, so to speak, or if you're talking about pouches, there is no secondhand. So already you're reducing the harm to society there. But more importantly, I think, is the social cost. You know, tobacco-related diseases cost this country and every country a lot of money in terms of healthcare and lives lost and productivity lost. And when ironically, this is a huge health measure. Getting smokers to switch to lower harm products is a health measure that the government doesn't even necessarily have to pay for. This is something that consumers will pay for on their own. We've seen this all around the world. They are willing to invest in their own health, and the results will trickle out to the whole of the economy and society.
I agree. And the other aspect of that as well is that when doing this, we have to be very careful not to medicalize the process. That's a big concern because a lot of smokers, they already feel under the gun. They already feel like they're being treated differently or second-class citizens. So if it's a consumer-driven phenomena, if it's readily available for people to be able to make the choice, they need to have the access to be able to make the choice. And if you medicalize it, you're going to lose a lot of people, especially in the lower socioeconomic bands, because they're not going to want to go and get yelled at again, because that's what happens. So yes, it will help the individual, and then it will also help society. The financial cost, depending on the taxation, a lot of families, you know, we saw it here in New Zealand, a lot of people were choosing between, you know, lunch and cigarettes, and the cigarettes won. You don't want to see that in Taiwan. You really don't want to see that. It's not fair to the children. And the social cost of that is not just now, but going forward. So,
yeah, of course, we are very interested to learn the experience from New Zealand and as well as other countries. But I think Taiwan have an advantage position to do this job because that we have a comprehensive national health insurance program. And during the process of legislation proposal, I think our government ignored the law of the national insurance program. And this program can provide financial incentive for all medical providers in Taiwan to establish the smoking cessation program, and which can help to communicate the smoking risk to general public in Taiwan. So I think the government should do more active job to provide smoking cessation program through the National Health Insurance Program, and this will provide financial incentive for all hospital and doctor to do a good job to help the individual smoker to reduce the smoking hazard, as well as to contribute the whole society to do the tobacco harm reduction. And I think that's the point that totally ignored by the government at this moment.
Fantastic. So now I'm going to ask about bans. And there's going to be a few different things. I had like three questions. I'm just going to put them in all into one. So what could be some of the negative effects of a total ban? What are some of the common reasons that people want to support these bans? And then do you guys believe that a flavor ban will help or discourage tobacco harm reduction?
Take that one. because of what we see in Asia, what we see in Thailand, for example, okay, bans don't work. Bans haven't been working in India either, okay? What it does is it pushes people to the illicit market. And the problem with an illicit market, not only is the government not receiving revenue, but the people who are using those products are not guaranteed the safety of those products. And that, in turn, causes more harm. Now, the flavor ban, again, it's based on an illusory idea that the flavors contribute to youth wanting to use the products. This has already been disproven, I don't know how many times already. It's a false economy, okay? Adults like flavors. I know for a fact that when I switched, and I'm pretty sure most vapers would tell you the same thing, that when they switched, they didn't want to taste the thing they were trying to get away from. So it defies logic. Does tobacco harm reduction can be done either the easy way or the hard way? And what I'm seeing is a lot of countries are going for the hard way because they're still doing quit or die. Quit or die doesn't work. Einstein was the person who said, if you keep doing the same thing the same way, why would you expect a different result? That's what we need to avoid.
Yeah, I'll add to that. One of the strategies, so this idea that, you know, it was brought up in another panel, are the flavors inherently dangerous? And I think the answer, as far as we know at this point, no. But this is why you don't want to push products into the black market with a flavor ban, for example, is because once we do know, regulations can then say, this harmful ingredient is no longer allowed to be added to the, you know, this particular flavor and cannot be added because it's harmful. We saw this with the cannabis, the E-Valley outbreak that was called the vaping lung injuries that was actually related to cannabis products, where illicit market dealers were adding an ingredient that was extraordinarily harmful. And the states that didn't already have that ingredient banned instantly act to make sure that ingredient was illegal in cannabis products. Now, one of the things that you can do instead of banning flavors, if attracting youth is the problem, because now let's see, if a child wants gummy bears, you know, a pack of gummy bears is a million times cheaper than a gummy bear flavored vape. So the problem can be seen as the advertising, right? So you don't necessarily need to get rid of the flavors, but as Clive was talking about, you can change how it is regulated to be marketed, right? You change the names, you change the colors, you change the scheme so that it maybe isn't gummy bears, it's some kind of sweet candy flavor that may not necessarily appeal to children. There are ways to go about this without banning, because once those things get pushed into the black market, people will still want them and the market will figure out a way to get people what they want. That's where it gets really dangerous and where the government and regulators and often scientists and academics have no ability to intervene in where things are getting dangerous.
Okay, let me add some point. I agree with all of you about the bad idea to ban the new tobacco product. But right now we are controversial or puzzled about the government plan. We ban e-cigarette but allow heated tobacco product. So people just get puzzled why we treat these two products in different way. And the point I want to make is that no matter how we do, if we just rely on regulation to ban some product, definitely it will create gray market and even bring the corruption to the government sector. As you know that our government sector have many scandals for for tobacco smuggling. It's not just for the ordinary people. Top government official will use the opportunity that the president take the plane to which foreign country, and they use that opportunity to bring a huge and tax tobacco product to Taiwan and put the top government official step down. So this is not just an illegal activity, this brings the corruption in the government sector. So many unintended sequence we need, consequence we need to consider for this kind of new product.
Fantastic. Well, I'm out of questions, but do any of you have any final thoughts before I let you all go?
No, just thank you for letting me be here.
Thank you.
All right.
Thank you, and thanks to the translators. I know there's probably hard work all night for them.
Yes.
Yes. Yes, we appreciate them. Well, excuse me, Tam, if you're ready to close out and everything. Again, thank you for having me moderate.
Thank you very much, Lindsay, and thank you very much to all of the participants. So just to conclude, I think that what we have learned today is very, very clear that harm reduction works, that reduced risk alternative to cigarettes, whether heat not burn or e-cigarettes, work and they save lives. And the question for Taiwanese and other lawmakers is, what model do you want to emulate? You have models such as our speaker spoke about in Japan, where the government is embracing the tobacco harm reduction lifestyle. You have examples in New Zealand, which has record reductions in smoking rates sort of fall, just plummeting since their government allowed for the sale of e-cigarettes and heat not burn devices. So the evidence is overwhelming. And the evidence for policymakers is such that these sort of regulations, if bans and over-regulations puts in place, it will jeopardize lives. So we are out of time, and in fact, we have gone a little bit over. Thank you once again to all of our panelists for joining us. Thank you for everyone who contributed in the chat with questions. We will be emailing out this presentation to everyone once it's uploaded on YouTube, but we would urge everyone in Taiwan in particular, but in all other countries, write to your lawmakers, write to your members of your elected officials, speak with them and educate them on the importance of the facts that we have discussed today. So thank you very much, everybody.